Neurotechnology is an exciting field. You can improve the quality of life for millions, uncover the hidden truths of the brain and consciousness, increase human capacity for learning, and freaking connect brains to computers. If this stuff interests you, you might ask, how do I get into the field of neurotechnology? In this video, we will answer the following questions about careers in neurotechnology. What subjects should I study? What universities should I go to? What level of education do I need? How do I get into the field? How do I get connected with other researchers in the field? What can I do to stay up to date with the field? And how can I get a job in neurotech? First, we'll deal with the question of what should I study and what should my background be to get into neurotech. In this video, we will focus on the disciplines that are most pertinent for designing, building, and implementing neurotechnologies, which are neuroscience and its derivatives, biomedical engineering, software engineering, and electrical engineering. Although this will be our focus, we want to emphasize that neurotech is really multidisciplinary, as is true in many budding industries. If you look in the right places, you can often find work in that space that aligns with your current background. For example, if you like communication and making videos, you could create a YouTube channel.
Let's take a look at the different fields involved in neurotechnology. Chances are, most neurotechnologists will have a specialty in one or more of these fields. It's generally recommended that you have a broad understanding of all these topics, as well as a deep understanding of at least one of them. First and foremost, it's important to note that many universities have been developing majors specifically for neurotechnologists in recent years. If a prospective school has neuroengineering or neuroengineering as a major, that might be your best bet. Otherwise, you might find one of the following subjects helpful to work with neurotechnology. Let's start with neuroscience. Regardless of which path you take, you'll need to at least gain some basic neuroscience knowledge. Knowledge of neuroscience will help you better understand the problems you're trying to solve with neurotechnology, and it'll provide you with the fundamental knowledge needed for working with brain-computer interfaces. Having knowledge of the biological components that you'll be interfacing with is invaluable to any neurotechnologist, so it's always worth researching neuroscience topics if you're going to be working with neurotechnology. If you're specifically interested in the research side of neurotechnology, you may choose to specialize in neuroscience in your career. There are great strides being made by neuroscientists every day, both in increasing our knowledge of the brain and how it works by developing more efficient medical devices to treat debilitating diseases. Neuroscience is a flexible career choice, as you can decide to focus on research or go more into the medical side and specialize in treatment. Computational neuroscience is sort of an amalgam of computer science and neuroscience. It provides the understanding of basic computational methods that are used for understanding what the nervous system does, and dives into algorithmic methods to determine how they function. This topic explores digital representations of information, such as that of spiking neurons, goes into the processing of information in neural networks, and provides information related to algorithms for adaptation and learning, specifically within the neuroscience field. If you know for sure that you want to lean more towards the software side of neurotechnology, but are also incredibly interested in the fundamentals and principles of neuroscience, computational neuroscience might be for you. The benefit of studying this field is that you can jump from research or medical fields to consumer or practical applications with relative ease. It's also incredibly helpful to establish that computer science understanding, as a common learning curve for most neuroscientists is learning how to code. Biomedical engineering is essentially the two above, but it's more broad and it's focused on solving biological problems. Instead of focusing on the brain, topics are much broader and can include any sort of medicine or device developed for medical uses. If you find yourself interested in the physical components involved in neurotechnology, you might want to consider electrical engineering as your focus. Electrical engineering provides a lot of foundational understanding of signal processing that is necessary for brain-computer interfacing applications. It also allows you to understand how the physical devices you're using actually function, and this knowledge can be invaluable for finding problems associated with a device that's malfunctioning. Understanding topics like filtering and signal processing are also really important if you're working with the brain-computer interfaces, especially for devices that use electroencephalography. Proper circuit design that, for example, cancels out noise from a nearby power line may make the processing of brainwave data easier on the software side. Incidentally, this is called a notch filter, and is commonly used for electroencephalographs to remove signal artifacts from power lines. Having the knowledge to create your own circuits that will capture and process biological data will, in many cases, also lead to innovation within the field of brain-computer interfacing. So, if your goal is to make your own brain-computer interfaces, maybe consider electrical engineering. The final component of neurotechnology is software. Depending on who you talk to, this is arguably the most important part of making a successful brain-computer interface. Having a solid background in software development is crucial because neurotechnologies typically involve processing large sums of complex data. In order to make sense of this data, neurotechnologies use a variety of tools such as machine learning and various other processing algorithms. Understanding how these complex algorithms work and how to utilize them properly is important for practically applying brain data. And these algorithms, along with filtering and feature extraction, is how a majority of complex neurotechnologies function. On the note of practical applications, having a knowledge of low-level coding languages is crucial for accomplishing tasks that communicate with external hardware. Languages like C and Arduino are used in a variety of BCIs and prosthetic companies, notably OpenBionics and OpenBCI. Regardless, an understanding of how to code and how to read code is crucial for any brain-computer interface enthusiast or professional.
Okay, so now you've got an idea of what to study, but how? Well, of course we would recommend that you take our free course, Foundations of Neurotechnology, which will give you a strong foundation of the basic information that you need to know. You can find it in our playlists right up here, on YouTube or on NeurotechX's neurotechedu.com. NeurotechEDU will be constantly updated with new content, so keep an eye out for that as well. For a good neuroscience class, we recommend Harvard's X-Series, Fundamentals of Neuroscience, on edX. Additionally, Computational Neuroscience of Neural Dynamics of Cognition from EPFL is a great course. If you're looking for a good textbook, we recommend Introduction to Brain-Computer Interfacing by Rajesh P.N. Rao. These are just a couple of options to get started, but the internet is a vast wealth of information. If you have your own educational goals and join communities or find mentors, you can get a pretty strong knowledge base. If you want to go the traditional route, the following universities have world-class neurotech research going on at their facilities. Go ahead and hit pause if you want to look through them. There will also be a list in the video description below. These universities all have excellent research or academic programs going on that will help you improve your technical understanding and gain credibility. As for the question of, do I need a degree / what kind of degree do I need to work in neurotech, the answer, of course, varies as it does in any industry. If you're going to work as a neuroscientist in the field of any position other than advisory, you pretty much need a PhD. Out of all the disciplines we just spoke about, this requires the most formal education. While you can certainly learn a lot of information online, in-person labs and publications will be very important for your credibility. This is similar for biomedical engineers and computational neuroscientists in that you will need a formal education in those areas for traditional jobs. However, you'll be able to work more readily with an undergraduate or master's degree when compared to neuroscience degrees. Electrical engineering is in the middle. Having a degree will certainly help, but demonstrated knowledge seems to be the most important. The limiting factor to a self-taught track, however, is access to equipment, so an undergraduate degree or higher is recommended. Computer science and software engineering are the most flexible. As is true with all of these, a degree will help bolster your credibility, but there are plenty of self-taught computer scientists out there, so it is not uncommon for them to land bigger jobs, as long as they have a good portfolio. There are tons of resources out there, and for the most part, the only equipment you'll need is a computer and some software. If you're an entrepreneur, you're going to have to make this call on your own. It's more about what knowledge you need to start your business and how you get it. One thing you might want to consider, though, is that a degree will likely be helpful in convincing investors that you know what you're talking about, but that might not be necessary.
This is an age-old question for scientists and engineers. Here are the pros and cons of each. Neurotech, specifically brain-computer interfaces, is still mostly within academia. So there's likely to be more job opportunities in academia for the time being. However, you'll almost certainly need a PhD to work in academia. Some of the perks are that you usually have more freedom to choose what you want to work on and your hours. You don't have to be thinking about profitability, you can just research for the sake of science as long as you get funded. The funding piece, though, is important. As an academic, you'll spend a lot of time jumping through financial and bureaucratic hurdles. You'll need to apply for grants, publish papers, likely teach classes and mentor students, and engage with your department and the larger community. If you like engaging with others and sharing your work, then academia is great. Companies put up walls around their IP, and academia has a lot less pressure. If you're self-motivated, patient, collaborative, and you like to learn and teach, then academia might be the right call for you. Working in industry also has its perks. The biggest one is pay. Working in industry pays 30% higher on average, and there's room for more promotion and salary growth. You don't have as much job security, but with new neurotech companies popping up all over the place and investment flooding in, there'll be plenty of job opportunities in the decades to come. While you can shop around for a company that fits your values and needs, you won't have as much control over what you work on. You might come on for one project and have it discontinued and have to work on another one. One nice thing about that lack of control, though, is you won't have to worry so much about the other stuff, such as getting grants or funding. Another downside is that you don't own your work or get the recognition that you would in academia. The other side of this coin is that the products that you develop will actually be used by people. Really, at the end of the day, it's a personal decision. So just ask yourself what you want and go from there.
A lot of people ask, how do I get into the field of neurotechnology? The simplest answer to this question is to get involved. Start by building knowledge and setting goals. After that, you can reach out to research groups at your university, join online communities such as NeurotechX's Slack group or OpenBCI's forums, work on personal or collaborative software and hardware projects and publish your results, look out for and report on industry trends, volunteer as a subject in local neurotech-related research, and engage in literature review and share your ideas. Another way to get involved is to participate in neuroscience-related hackathons or other such community events. Conferences are also a great way to meet people within the space, and many such events, while now virtual, have breakout rooms or other social opportunities where you can meet people with other interests in the field. Never doubt the power of a random connection. This is a tough question. The best way to get a job in the field of neurotechnology is likely going to be related to connections. And as is true with any industry, being active on LinkedIn or other professional websites are a great way to reach out to potential employers and showcase your neurotech projects. It is also very helpful for finding opportunities and keeping yourself up to date within neurotech. Side note, another great way to stay up to date with neurotechnology is to set Google Alerts. These alerts will send you an email whenever new studies or advances in certain technologies, like EEG, are made. We get most of our video ideas, podcasts, guests, and find out about conferences through our LinkedIn and social feeds. On the note of projects, the number of projects and the quality of these projects that you've worked on in the past will likely play a role in getting you the position. Having demonstrated interest in neurotechnology will give you a huge leg up. Because the field of neurotechnology is so new and growing quickly, most companies expect their hires to be new to neurotech. If you can go to an employer and say, "Hey, I'm trained as a software engineer, but I'm also really interested in neurotech," you will get picked for that job 9 times out of 10 as long as your base qualifications are the same. Lastly, look through neurotech companies or labs' hiring pages. Oftentimes, you can apply or reach out to recruiters through these methods. We recommend that you take a look at neurotech.com's mind map for a list of over 450 companies. You can look through this and maybe some will match your interests and then you can reach out.
It's such an exciting time to be a neurotechnologist. We hope that all these pointers will be helpful for you on your journey. We're working on compiling a list of great neurotech resources on our website. Feel free to give us recommendations too. As always, don't forget to subscribe and follow us across other social media. We have a YouTube, Twitter, Instagram, and a LinkedIn. We're frequently posting about new developments, job and research opportunities, and conference on those platforms. Also, a big thank you to Mr. MedTech himself, Giovanni Loricello, for advising us on the content to include in this video. If you are a startup looking to raise capital or to hire, you should check him out. Thanks again.